as somebody here who actually had a big hand in inventing the World Wide Web, well, Sam Gassel.
Wait, is Al Gore here?
No, well, Sam Gassel created the code for one of the very first web browsers that made
it possible. No. I put CNN on the web. Everyone else went there.
Worked on that early Mosaic software that allowed people to get to the web. Do you see technical solutions to this?
Mulling them? It comes down to the humans, and it does come down to that logistical effort. You know, if in advance of the debates you had collated, you know, all the things they were likely to speak about and the ways in which
that.
And so there's all that effort in advance, plus the real time, plus getting anyone to listen to it, which actually is a nice lead into the I'm not sure whether it's a softball or a screwball that I'm going to throw in here, but it's well meant.
The page views, you would get 18 to 20 million page views on those reality shows.
That's a good bet.
Huge number.
That's a good bet. That's a good, I didn't know that number, so that's a good bet.
What do people here think about the social media platforms to take that issue a little bit further? Should they take a position, should they try to police what's on their sites more than they do now?
You know, at the end of the day, there's still the First Amendment. And I get really bothered when I watch universities that have journalism schools in them, and they're saying you can't say certain phrases on campus. And the only time you can say what's on your mind is in this 4x4 box off in a remote corner of the campus is the only time you can speak your mind. And I think we're developing a culture where, you know, we're nipping the Fourth Amendment. I mean, the First Amendment, we won't have the First Amendment anymore if we keep on that course. And I think, you know, we're creating, or you want to create that on social media. And I think Zuckerberg has come out and said, you know, am I supposed to be the arbiter of speech, of what is acceptable and what's not acceptable?
So, one thing, I think it was the Kathleen Hall Jamison article you mentioned, one of the things that, and other studies that I've read have found is that particularly through social media, which has that social trust in it, that once a lie is seeded, even repeating it to debunk it tends to enhance it and make it more plausible and make it more believed in the future, which is, along with our colleague Brooks Jackson, has been working on fact check and so on forever. And the enterprise is not taking for some reason. So my question for you is there maybe a rhetorical change that needs to happen? Because when CNN puts on the same panel its anchor, its reporter, its professional analyst and its partisans who are not subject to the same standards, which it was your job to enforce, but they're not all subject to the same standard, but they're all the same panel. And so there's no question of, hey, that's a ragged, I didn't know about the ragged
right margin,
but there's no question of that. So it undermines what you're doing.
I think that comes back to the issue of clarity. Where is the boundary? Analysis and punditry, and that's become blurred not just on CNN but in many other places because they're all sitting in one panel.
Right. Fox viewers can't tell when the news ends.
Figure it out even with a font on the bottom of the screen.
Yeah. You know, but they've got the same font.
The same graphics package.
Yeah.
Fox viewers can't tell when the news ends and the commentary begins.
I first wanted to apologize for walking out at the feet of the meter, but I'd like to say this. I think some of the issue that we're having is that the citizens should be able to distinguish themselves between what's fake. You go check another source, you know. I think it's sort of an indictment of our educational system, the lack of teaching civics and knowing the three branches of government and was it for the state and why it's there and those things. So I think that's somewhat of an indictment of our education system. As well, I think that some of the fake news also is contributing to the fact that our media has become so corporatized. And back in the day, media didn't have to earn money.
Well, it always had to
it was easier.
But you're talking about community standards. You're talking about, you know, just, I know the FCC doesn't control, you know, the cable part, but then there's still some things that I think, you know, the fairness doctrine, all those things that have kind of fallen away has somewhat to be contributed to all of these issues that we're talking about now. And you'll never be able to combat fake news if it's all about the social impact that, you know, the person and how they begin to, how they filter it themselves.
Well, during the time that you were talking about all Americans pretty much getting their news from common sources, there were only three national broadcast networks with three different sets of anchors.
And Walter Cronkite was the most trusted man in America.
Yeah.
Master man.
And now you have a huge, you have, what's the population of the United States?
320 million.
So we've got 324 million people on the web writing stuff.
I think we have time for one more. Gerry, did you have a...
I had a question kind of about the enabling function of the media in perpetuating fake news. Because I guess in my mind, a random tweet from Trump at 2 o'clock in the morning is not news, especially when it's going to be contradicted 12 hours later. But that tends to be the lead story on so many news outlets, analyzing what those 12 words or 14 words meant.
Right.
And it becomes a story because
right.
Of
right. But first of all, he has millions of followers. So,
some of them are real.
Not as many, not all of them are real. But the reason, so Trump gets so much coverage, and this was true during the campaign, so he got way more coverage than any other Republican candidate, even in the general election, more coverage than and a lot of the negative that, right? Because he attracts ratings. I mean, that's it. I mean, you cover Trump and you get ratings. And you know, that's what it's about.
As we're running out of time, there's a question I've missed back to the back.
Yeah, well, the one thing I wanted to share with y'all about like how fake news can be. I don't know if you remember when the attorney, Trent Quinn, got shot in Midtown several months ago. They started a fake news campaign about her that she had that morning gone to get information from the district court and she got shot by Islamic terrorists. And so people were posting this and it made me angry because I know her actually. And so I had to say, this is a lie, this is not true. Like, I know her, she works for UPS as an in-house lawyer. Like, she's not going, like they were, you know, saying that she was asking about the interstate collapse and that's why she got murdered. And it was like a crazy story that made no sense, but people were believing it and sharing it. And one of my good friends, who is a smart, liberal, educated lawyer, was like, do you know about this? And I go, this is a total lie. I know this woman. So this is like how scary, like smart, intelligent, educated people can be influenced by
this. Story about the DMC.
Yes, the Seth guy.
He was responsible for giving the
WikiLeaks, yeah.
The email to the media and told a lot.
It's terrifying. It's terrifying.
And why do they leave? Yeah. Why do they leave on the right? But also on the far left. So there were a lot of Bernie Sanders supporters who bought into that. And because it fit in with their present notion of that the Clinton campaign was corrupt, and they would actually kill someone. Yeah.
But I think we were making a valid point that it is through the sourcing that went to your friend who's a well-educated lawyer, someone forwarded that to her, which gave it the credibility that she read it and then came to you and said, did you see this? And it, in her passing along to you, if you you didn't know anything about the case, you would have said, this is a well-educated lawyer. She's sharing this. So for all of us, sharing carefully is a huge prophylactic for the spread of this stuff. So there we go. Use your prophylactic.
Was there one more?
Can I do one more? I think on credibility. I'm the self-serving politician, and I have a degree in journalism, so I'm twice bitten on this thing. But I'm a huge First Amendment advocate in Georgia government. But one thing I see is, and I grew up in the era of broadcast giants and print media giants that could have been elected president of the United States if he wanted to. Walter Cronkite probably could. But one thing I see is now we have to have the experts on the news. And we have to have the expert analysis. And then when you see James Clapper, who's lied to Congress two times under oath, and David Petraeus, who had been under the rank of colonel, would be in Leavenworth doing 20 years right now, and you're seeing quotes from the Huff Post, and the editor of Huff Post wrote this blatantly biased piece against Donald Trump. I mean, openly saying, let me tell you why I hate this man. And then they get quoted in major newspapers as a source, and I'm just wondering, how do you clean that up?
Well,
because that's why people are clicking the channel.
Probably will think back to Melvin Melcher, since you trained. For those of you who didn't go to journalism school, there's a theory about the layers of journalism. It was originally put out there by Melvin Melcher, who was a professor from Long Island who went to work at Columbia. And I actually use it a lot within CNN and have expanded on it a lot. I won't give into my one-hour lecture on this, but the three basic concepts are, layer one journalism is what you learn from the news release, the news conference, the police blotter, a train wreck has occurred, a plane has crashed, the basics that a story occurred. Layer two journalism is holding the officials accountable for what they said in the news conference, what they said in the tweet, why did the plane crash, what are the underpinnings of the story. Then layer three is analysis and opinion.